visions of Venus, goddess of love, our closest neighbor, between us and the light that feeds us all. This is an image from June of 2012 during the Venus transit, and we could see the goddess cross the orb of the sun disk. So close to the sun, but we're going to start far, far away with a new planet, a dwarf planet. Actually, when she was found, this is when Pluto was demoted. Eris is her name. Goddess of discord. So when Thetis and Peleus were to be married, all gods and goddesses were invited, except for Eris. And this pissed her off. So she played a little trick, a trick that had great consequences. She threw a golden apple into the midst of the wedding party. An apple marked Callisti, for the fairest, and the goddesses fought for the prize. Who indeed was the fairest of them all? It came down to three: Hera, Athena, and Aphrodite. And these three demanded that Zeus be the judge. He said, "Hell no, I'm not that crazy." It was decided a mortal would judge this competition, who was the fairest of these three beautiful goddesses. A mortal found on a mountaintop, the same mountain where Zeus was raised by wood nymphs and fed the milk of a goat. A shepherd who was born a prince to the great king of Troy, Priam. But his mother, the day before delivering him, had had a dream of bad omens, of fire, brimstone. So the king sought advice at the oracle, and he was told that a child born to royalty the next day would be the downfall of Troy. So of course, when the king's sister, Scylla, gave birth the next morning, the baby and the mother along with it were destroyed, burned, sacrificed to the gods. As you will, when the oracle speaks. "Thank the gods it is not my son," said the king. "My son is not to be the royal, born of this day of bad omen." But before the sun set, he was. The king could not bear to kill his wife, Hecabe. It was decided the child must die, though. He was, after all, prophesied to be the downfall of this great kingdom of Troy, the greatest kingdom. Hecabe could not bear to kill her child, so she gave this task to the head herdsman, Aegeus. He took the child into the wilderness, but he could not kill it, not with sword, not with stone, not with rope. Surely, if he left the child to die, that's exactly what it would do. But instead, this young boy was found by a she-bear and suckled by the bear for 5 days until Aegeus returned to this miracle, the child lived. And he knew this was a sign, and he knew that he should keep this child as his own. It said he brought it home to his wife in a wallet. And then this word wallet, in ancient Greek, was said Paris. So this was the name of this young boy, Paris, who grew up a herdsman. And when he was just past childhood, managed to rout a bunch of cattle thieves and win their herd back. Now, his beauty gave him away as a prince. And though he had a title just barely above that of a slave, a great sea nymph, Lenone, took him to marry. His favorite sport was to face the bulls of Aegeus's herd against one another. And the champion bull he would crown in flowers, and the loser in straw. When a bull won again and again, he would match this victor against bulls of neighboring herds. And at some point, he declared he would offer a crown of gold to the victor that could beat his greatest bull. Now, none of the myths say where this young shepherd, just above the status of slave, could get a crown of gold, but I guess he did. In Aries, Mars took the challenge, turning himself into a bull. He fought and he won. Without hesitation, Paris crowned Aries in gold. So he was known to be a just mortal, a fair mortal. And later, as a prince, for when his father Priam asked for one of Aegeus's greatest bulls for the games, Paris decided to go with it, and he competed, and he won at boxing, and he won at the race more than once. Priam's known sons decided to kill him. And just as that was about to go down, Aegeus declared the truth. Paris, king, is your son. He is a prince. And provided a rattle from the child's youth as confirmation. Priam took his son into the castle, did not heed the oracle that was said the night before his birth. And surely he would be the downfall of Troy. And he would be the judge, for who was the fairest? Zeus gave the golden apple to Mercury, said, "You take these three women to Mount Ida, find there Paris, the just, and he will decide." Hera, Athena, Aphrodite stood before the young mortal. He said, "Mercury, should I judge them in their clothes?" And Mercury said, "Hey man, you're the judge here, whatever you think. It's probably best if they disrobe then." And so they did. And one at a time they stood before him. And he judged their beauty, and he judged their bribes. Hera first, Hera, wife of Zeus. She promised Paris that he would be a great king of Europe and Asia alike. Now, how could he refuse this? Next, Athena, goddess of wisdom, born from the crown of Zeus, fully clad in armor of bronze. And she told Paris that if he chose her, he would be ever wise. He would never lose at any game of strategy. And then it was Aphrodite's turn, which maybe wasn't fair. For her beauty was unmatched. And she told Paris that if he chose her, Hera, Athena, and Aphrodite, she told Paris that if he chose her, surely he would marry the most beautiful mortal who ever lived. The apple was given to Aphrodite. And so the story usually comes down as the folly of man. So this choice, Hera, well, Athena offered the air. She offered the mind, the strategy. Hera, the fire, the will to be a great king. And Aphrodite, the body, she who was most beautiful. Paris chose the body. He chose beauty. And should we blame him? For Venus is about beauty. Taurus is about beauty. It's about the earth. Consider a tree. Capricorn, the roots, the structure, the trunk. Virgo, the leaves, reaching for spirit always, reaching for the light, devoted in that quest. And the inner workings, the photosynthesis. But Taurus, oh, Taurus is the fruit. The apple itself. Did that get us in trouble? Taurus is the flower. The rose. Thank you. The roses need our noses, and Taurus knows this best. Let's lay down and be beautiful bulls. But what's with the bulls? What's with the balls, y'all? Well, speaking of, Saturn castrated his father Uranus, and the blood from this exchange found its way to the oceans below, giving birth to Aphrodite, Venus, goddess of love, beauty, grace, harmony, intimacy, dance, said to represent the Taurus mysteries. The bull kind of seems like bullshit. How is the bull representative of this grace, the smooth lines, joy, childbirth, beauty, harmony? If we go back in time, long ago, to a time we know now as the age of the bull, we find many depictions of this sun disk between the bull's horns. And we're handed down this Apis bull. But if you trace the tips of these horns to their base at the skull, over brow and nose, cheek and chin and chest, move a little further and you will find udders. This is no bull at all. Cow. In Egypt, Hathor or Hethor, goddess, beauty, grace, joy, harmony, whose milk fed the gods, whose milk gave rise to the Milky Way. In other lands, Lakshmi, sacred cow, goddess of abundance. And we are told by many that Taurus is bull, and therefore stubborn and thick-skinned, bull-headed, materialistic, that it's all about the gold, baby. This energy can be driven in that direction. It's encouraged to be. By our friends named Lynch and their and their kings. But what about that grace? What about the smooth lines? What about the udders? How were they sawed off? How was this holy cow testiculized? The cow whose milk fed the gods, Hathor cow, slowly over time losing her form, becoming woman with cow features, and more woman, perhaps to save that space for this bull. Hathor, Hethor. These horns, then, what are they if they are feminine? We see them on many goddesses in the Egyptian depictions, including on Isis herself, mother of Horus, sister and wife of Osiris, the queen, the first virgin mother. Cows have horns, and especially at this angle, well, they might relate to that. Female reproductive system on a bad day. And why a bad day? Well, perhaps because this goddess whose milk fed the gods is a little pissed that her udders were removed and replaced with a couple of those. So this stubborn cow, what's that about? Well, Taurus is the Epicurean, named after this old gent. Epicureanism, this word these days seemingly reserved for the foodie. But Epicureanism is about all of the senses. So taste, yes, but sight, smell, hearing, touch, especially touch. For Taurus is intimacy as an art form. Tantra, it is the body and the body's pleasures. So stubborn, well, the whole trip with the Epicurean is to find something that brings pleasure, something that feels right, something that allows us to feel spirit here in the manifest realm. And once it's found, why should we not stick with that? Tantra, the body, yoga, this is the place of Taurus. So let's come out of the astral airs for a moment and find our bodies. Jennifer Olson's gonna lead us in a little rinky-dinky yoga exercise. Nothing too strenuous, don't stress, just stretch.
So much so that that comes all the way back up, reverberating through our bodies and ascends out through the crown of the head, up into the cosmos, and this balance of heaven and earth. So we're grounded and rooted in our seat, we still reach up tall. Turn your left palm up facing the sky and keep your right palm down, either resting on your lap or your knee. And find that balance, feminine and the masculine, sun and the moon, healer and warrior. Take a nice long deep breath in through the nose and open the mouth and let everything out. Shoulders up towards the ears, you breathe in. Open the mouth, let everything out. The shoulders drift down away from the ears. Nice. Another one like that. Breathe in. Let the shoulders up towards the ears. Exhale everything out. Allow everything to melt back down through those roots, back down into the earth. Giving thanks. As we bring our hands together at our hearts, acknowledging the warrior and the true teacher that lives within each and every one of us. As we are individuals, yet we melt that boundary, the barrier, to receive the collected, collective. And next breath, and as you reach our hands up towards the sky, let's interlace the fingers and press the sky away. As you press the sky away, maybe even feel more rooted in your seat. Again, breathing and lift the shoulders up towards the ears. And as you breathe out, just allow the shoulders to drift down away. And let's take a nice side bend over towards our right. So stretching, opening up that left side body. Shining that feminine side. Take a nice long breath in here. As you breathe out, just drop the right hand down towards the floor. Let the left hand just drape down and forward. Coming to a nice forward fold. Resting your forehead on the floor, stacking your fists into a tower, allowing your forehead to rest.
Where were we? Right, the body. I haven't used that term rinky-dink in a long time. Please pardon that. And that sixth chakra, the third eye, the bull's eye. You ever wonder about that? Like, was there this ancient sport of throwing darts at bull's eyes? Seems a little risky. Well, Hathor was known in many ways. One was as the eye of Ra. And one of Ra's representations is that of bull. Hard to see in this image. You can kind of see Orion on the left here. That was Osiris, yeah? And the two very bright ones have to be Jupiter and Venus. And I'm not sure about the smaller one. I'm guessing Mars. In a straight line through those, you can see the Pleiades, seven sisters, Subaru. And then to the left of those, see that red star right in the middle of the top there? That's Aldebaran, which is said to be the eye of the bull. Maybe easier on the fake picture. The two stars of Orion's belt on this side, they point right at it. It's now processed into Gemini territory. But back in the day, in the age of the bull, it was right at the vernal equinox point, which is what made it the age of the bull. So I'm not going to get into the whole procession rap now, but many of you heard me talk about that. This is a long time ago. This is like 3055 BC on this particular projection. And that's the vernal equinox, where the ecliptic and the celestial equator cross in spring. And what constellation is aligned to that point is said to define the age of man that we are in. And so at that time, the age of the bull, right, when it was aligned with the bullseye. Very similar shot, but this one's from 3114 BC. So I ran that because that was the beginning of the known Mayan calendar that just ended, and so we're not alive anymore. But you are. So back to Kem, the land of Hemet, Egypt, now called. And last time we talked about some reasons that authors have put forth that say the Sphinx was named Mars, but that's not what we hear from mystery keepers in Egypt. Hakim Arian, I really recommend you check this guy out online. He's amazing. And his son and daughter-in-law give tours in Egypt now. I've been talking to them recently. And Patricia Arian told me this about Hathor. In Egypt, in the hieroglyphics, there's no vowels. So Hathor is kind of a guess, or maybe what was passed down. H-T-H-R once it's translated. Also called Hethor. And what Patricia wrote to me was, Hathor, or Hethor, is the womb of creational potentials. She is sound, the spark of life. She is rhythm and vibration, without which we are not alive. She embodies the divine feminine principle and is the place of the or, the masculine, making her the alpha and the omega, all that is, ever was, and ever shall be. And as Jennifer just brought to our attention, our left side is known as the feminine side of our halves. Right brain, left side. So when you look at these images of the pharaohs, these so-called kings see that it's always their left foot forward, the feminine side. And Hakim puts forth, with much knowledge, that this was a time of matriarchy. Hathor, Her Highness, maybe it could be pronounced Heather as well. And if we look at the Sphinx, it sure looks like a woman. And as I've said before, looking at the vernal equinox point due east, waiting for that constellation of the water bearer to rise. Perhaps part of this new age of Aquarius, of what's necessary for it to come forth, is the balancing of the masculine and the feminine to honor the water bearer as both, as human. So time to get the balls off the bowls. Time to stop throwing darts at them, maybe. Because sometimes they get theirs. They always know where to aim, it seems, as well. We're running from the bulls. What is this madness? The rat race, you know? Taurus is more like Ganesha than the rat on which he rides. Taking it slow. Please slow down. This is the truth in the light of Taurus, connected to the earth. Taking things at earth's pace, like the cow that has four stomachs. It's a slow digestion. Like the leaves that slowly crumble to give their energy back to earth to be born as new life. Can even slow the squirrels down for a little bit. If Pisces is the womb, coming back from transcendence is the birth, is Aries the first house, and then Taurus would be this stuff, getting something to eat. Taurus is about sustenance, what gives us nutrition, what provides. So we can look back to Lakshmi, ensure she has her plate of gold, which seems to be streaming forth from her very palm in this depiction. The goddess of abundance is abundance, that plate of gold. And the bowl might tell us it is. It might tell us this is what Taurus is about. But look at all of the other forms of abundance in this beautiful painting, including the painting itself. When we focus solely on the finances, as we're very much coached to do, we lose focus on the many forms of abundance. What about love and friendship? What about guidance and support, truth, comfort, shelter, food? Taurus is about receiving. The only one of the 12. There are many, many givers. And we are taught giving is receiving, and it's better to give than receive, of course. But sometimes receiving is giving, and Taurus knows this. And when we can tap into our principle of beauty and love, then we know we deserve to receive. So you get that half-hour foot rub, and there's no tinge of guilt knowing you have to return the favor. Or the giver takes over, it's like, oh, I'm going for 40 minutes then. I will never receive more than I give. And the receiver knows that what the giver truly wishes in return is simple, pure, honorable acknowledgement of the gift they give. That was the best foot rub of all time in the history of mankind. You are the best and I love you. That is the gift of the giver. So sometimes receiving is giving. can we learn that? Beautification. It's a bad slide that comes up on Google when you type in beautification. I'm not even sure if that's a word. But this is Taurus. It's about beauty. So it's beautifying the surroundings, beautifying the self, bringing spirit into this material realm so that it can be observed. Why would spirit not wish for this? So we're told it's materialistic. No. Taurus doesn't wear the ring because it costs a bunch of money. Because she sees spirit in it. And because it's beautiful. And it makes others feel beautiful and alive. So as within, so without. And nature is the best reflection of our inner beauty. Can we slow down? Can we go hug a tree? This is my favorite, the Empress. Smells like lavender and pepper. It's amazing. I highly recommend a dance with the Empress tree. And when we honor that beauty of nature, and when we connect to nature at her pace, then we are reminded of our inner beauty, for we are nature. But enough about the bowl, enough about Taurus. Let's talk about Venus. Or let's listen to some Venus. So we're gonna have another song, this time from Janell Hartman.
Things change, some stay the same. something is lost and something is found, and they will keep on speaking your name. Some things change, some stay the same. I'll keep repeating until you get it, okay? And she will always carry on. Something is lost and something is found, and they will keep on speaking your name. Some things change, some stay the same. Yet she will always carry on. Something is lost and something is found, and they will keep on speaking your name. Some things change, some stay the same. One more time.
Janell Hartman. You know, they say in the random astrologer speaking at yoga studios business that if you're gonna borrow stuff from, make sure the frogs are humping when the woman sings about letting me inside you. It was not planned. Nor was this. Venus, all right. Well, let's talk astrology for a moment then, shall we? We'll look at what a few of my favorite astrology books have to say about Venus. They differ greatly. So take your pick. This is from A Handbook for the Humanistic Astrologer. No, it's not. Astrology for Yourself, Douglas Block and Demetra George. Venus symbolizes the capacity to attract the people and things we love and value. Venus represents the core essence of the feminine nature. Through her powers of divine beauty and magnetic desirability, she ignites the spark of the creative process. She is the wellspring of the feminine vital force, which begets and renews life. Venus was known to the Greeks as Aphrodite, goddess of love and beauty. In her earlier Asiatic origins, she was also worshipped as a nature goddess and primal mother of all ongoing creation. As the embodiment of grace, harmony, and loveliness, Venus cultivates beauty through the arts and social graces. She endows a natural elegance and refined aesthetic sense. In Venus's world, beauty of form and harmony of living heal and uplift the human soul. A Handbook for the Humanistic Astrologer, by Michael Meyer. Traditional meaning is harmony, art, beauty, and affection, the ability to attract others and maintain relationships. But the humanistic meaning, the centripetal force active within experience, all attempts to reach the center and partake in communion with oneself and others. Ascetics and the establishment of a pattern of appreciation and a set of values and ideals. The expression of internal experiences. The classic, I know you all have this one. Jane Rudyard. This guy is amazing, though, if you want to learn more about astrology and have patience and love great writing, check him out. That which goes out from the psyche as Mars returns to it as Venus. Venus is the effect experienced as a result of the way in which the outer world reacts to our Martian outgoing. The Martian impulse returns home filled with experience, probably with bruises, and possibly with wisdom. Venus is the end of the experience and what we have gathered as a result of it. Thus, it is the purveyor of consciousness, of knowledge, and wisdom to the ego. It is symbolized by bees because bees bring back to the hive the honey gathered from the flowers, which are also the last product of the plant. The soul of relationship is love. Mars love is the love that is desire, self-projection, root force towards self-reproduction in and through others, but with no regard for the others. Venus love is the love that is wise, the love that arises from true interchange, from altruistic companionship, love wisdom. The Inner Sky by Stephen Forrest. If the sun is king and moon is queen, then the princess of the heavens must surely be Venus. Her light is dim compared to them, but she outshines everything else in the sky. She is the most exquisite jewel in the celestial storehouse. If you find yourself touched by the poetry of these words, then you are also touching the part of yourself that astrologers call Venus. She is the goddess of beauty, balance, harmony, equilibrium. These are the keys to the Venus vibration. She may lead us to create harmony between colors, shapes, and sounds, or to respond to a harmony that is already there. Venus gives birth to our aesthetic perceptions. It is she who puts the tear in our eye as we watch the sun set over that snowy field. Jungian Symbolism in Astrology by Alice Howell. Venus rules what Jung called Eros, the feminine capacity in both men and women to be affectionate and to reach out to others in a human and loving way as well as in an erotic manner. We have to distinguish between Venus in a man's and a woman's chart. Venus in a man's chart will show his ideal of the feminine and will be close to what Jung termed the anima in a man's psyche. It will show his capacity for social relationship and his capacity to express the non-rational side of his nature, his moods, and his vulnerability. Venus in a woman's chart will show her capacity to relate to her own femininity and express it. The positive side of Venus is truly lovely and has to do with youth, beauty, maidenhood, vulnerability, and natural innocence. The glyph of Venus is the circle of spirit over the cross of matter, a constant reminder that spirit is amidst us in the cosmic order, harmony, and beauty of this world and our aesthetic capacities to appreciate these and to participate in them. He who does not join the dance mistakes the occasion, says the Gospel of John. Dance is ruled by Venus. And in the Shamanic Astrology Handbook by Daniel Giammario and Kaylin Castell, apparently now available in a Kindle version. And since it's the Taurus month and that means you're supposed to buy a bunch of stuff, if you want to learn more about Shamanic Astrology, check it out. You can get this for $10 on Amazon. Venus on a woman's chart represents what version of the feminine principle she is working on in the current life. A woman's Venus answers Freud's famous question, what does woman want? In shamanic astrology, there are 12 different answers depending on what Venus position the woman has. Taurus, for example, is associated with the lover. Her intent is to bring spirit fully into the physical and experience the deepest intimacy on the basis of friendship and trust. She wants to be fully honored, loved, and savored as a master of intimacy, where lovemaking is an art form. Venus on a man's chart represents what qualities of the feminine principle he is most attracted to. Similar to Jung's anima, Venus is associated with the magical feminine. These are the qualities of the feminine the man must develop within himself in order to get the sacred marriage, which for a man is when he walks with the qualities of his inner woman on his arm at all times, regardless of whom he is with or whether he is with anyone at all. The circle of spirit and the cross of matter. And the pentagram, this symbol associated within the mysteries with goddess Venus, and for good reason, the five-petaled rose is maybe a better expression of hers. We're going to watch Venus's synodic dance, which has to do not only with Venus's orbit around the sun, but also with Earth. So at that time of starting, Earth and Venus were together. And during their mutual orbits, they align also in this opposition, other side of the sun, but it's not an opposition astrologically. Because Venus is between us and the sun, when you look to Venus in that position, you also see the sun. And when you look to Venus when she's between Earth and sun, you see the sun. So Venus has two types of conjunctions, the interior, this one, and the exterior when she's on the other side. Old astrology calls those inferior and superior, but we try to avoid such patriarchal language in shamanic astrology. So now watch her dance over the time. When she has those interior conjunctions, we're going to put her mark on the screen. And over the course of 8 years, you will see a pattern developed that will repeat itself. starts at another point with one of those interior conjunctions. And 584 days later, she's reborn in the morning sky at another point. And every 8 years, she's back where she started. Barely moves. And it forms this pentagram around the earth and our sky. It's known to the ancients for a long, long time. This five-petaled rose. Shamanic astrology, we honor these cycles, these synodic cycles. So we all have Venus on our chart, which talks about our feminine, whether we are man or woman. But there's also this kind of global overtone of the feminine intent, which starts with the synodic cycle. Venus was just recently reborn in Capricorn. She's been doing Gemini since that Venus transit in 2012 in June. In January of this year, she was reborn Capricorn goddess. It might be hard to see this chart, but if you can, you can track back to the date before your birthday, and that's your Venus overtone. And if you want to come up close and see it later, afterwards we can do that. Last time we looked at this strange five-sided pyramid on Mars. And maybe it's saying Venus was here, for that's her sign. And this geometry, this sacred geometry, holds the key to the golden ratio. So maybe this place isn't all about war. Okay, it is. But this is not. And this isn't devil stuff. The golden proportion in the shape of every divine pentagram, the number one, the ratio of one, to phi, the golden number, the golden spiral. And I think maybe another time we can look a little deeper into sacred geometry. But Venus holds this. She carries the nature of this Fibonacci sequence, which defines the golden number, the golden length, the golden section, the golden rectangle, the golden pentagram. Fibonacci sequence is shown here on the left. It actually starts with zero, which is not shown. And the next number is one, and then you add the previous two numbers to get the next, so zero plus one is one. And then 1 plus 1 is 2, and 1 plus 2 is 3, and 2 plus 3 is 5, and 5 plus 3 is 8, and then 13, and 21, and 34, and it goes on and on. So Venus does her thing every 8 years, and in that time, she makes 13 trips around the sun while the Earth makes 5. So the very nature of her synodic dance is very balanced, very beautiful, very sacred. Where Mars, the masculines, is a little bit hard to keep your finger on the pulse of. This golden number, phi, shows itself all over the place in nature. The divine spirals. We see here numbers 8 and 13. The Nautilus, this golden spiral defined by a series of golden rectangles. It's in our ear. It's in huge things as well. The ancients knew about this. Our body knows all about it, especially that leaf part. And the spiral chest hair on my friend here. We are made in this divine proportion according to this golden number in many, many ways. Leonardo knew about this. Rabbit reproduction. according to the golden number. Start with a pair of bunnies, then you get another after a month. Quick little bunnies. Then two pairs make three, and three pairs make five, and five pairs make eight. So back to the love making. Venus, born of the blood of Uranus, castrated Phallus, that his son Saturn had the pleasure of removing for him, was then later adopted by Zeus as his daughter. So how's that for the patriarchy? How's that work? The nephew adopts his aunt. Interesting. Zeus then married Aphrodite, Venus, goddess of love and beauty, to the only god who was not said to be of divine form, to Hephaestus, or Vulcan in the Roman, who was a cripple, and an unbelievable metalsmith, a wizard at the forge. He made all the weapons and the magical devices, even Zeus's toys. Aphrodite was not pleased, and she spent a lot of time sneaking around with her undercover lover, who was Mars, Ares. In fact, her three children with Hephaestus were actually her three children with Mars. And one day they got busted. Hephaestus was told of their secret interlopings, and he left town for a while, knowing they would meet and forge this metal net, and he trapped them in the act for all the gods and goddesses to come and see. The goddesses refused to participate with shaming this woman, but the gods all came. Hermes, Mercury, was like, dude, I'll be trapped in the net with her all day, all year. And later, actually, he was in a way rewarded for this, because Aphrodite came to his bedroom and they gave birth to a child who was the first hermaphrodite. And that was her, his name, actually. So I feel sorry for Hephaestus in this deal more than the others, maybe. But it's possibly also a telling of this stripping away of our Mars and our Venus, our masculine and feminine. Maybe since the aunt was adopted by nephew. And something we're meant to bring back together. And so one thing I love about this synodic cycle, is we look at this for Mars as well, and while Venus was recently reborn in January from 19 months of Gemini into 19 months of Capricorn, where she is now, Mars, just on April 8th, was reborn in the shamanic astrology perspective as the Libra god. He had spent 26 months, as he does, about doing Virgo, and now it's Libra. So Venus from Gemini to Capricorn, Mars from Virgo to Libra, both of them from mutable to cardinal, if you're hip to that astrolingo. In shamanic astrology, we call the cardinal signs householders and tradition keepers. I call them service to others, and we call the mutable signs service to spirit. So both the masculine and feminine principles, overtones of that, have shifted recently from service to spirit to service to others, to the relationship category. And I imagine we're going to hear a lot of wedding bells ringing over the next little while here. Because Venus, the feminine, has been doing this flirty Gemini circus performer eternal youth thing for a while, as she should. And Mars, the masculine, has been doing the green man in the forest, the priest. And now she is Capricorn, who, in my mind, is the wise elder, the wisdom keeper. And Mars, reborn as the Libra god, the diplomat, he with ears to listen to her wise advice. So hopefully it's a time of this, so we can stop doing all of this. Which has kind of been the scene for a long time. I mean, if you look at these traditional planets, well, I guess I should stop here. Just think about Venus and Taurus, the horns and the pentagram, right? How demonized are those? These are the traditional planets, the planets that we can see with the naked eye, from Mercury to Saturn, Moon, Sun, Venus, Mars, Jupiter. How many of those are masculine? Most of them. Only Venus and the Moon are traditionally associated with feminine mysteries. So that's maybe where Eris comes in. But she's the goddess of discord, right? Well, maybe our feminine half has a right to be pissed off. But there's other feminine planets available to us in the astrological system too. And before I even go there, they're planets, right? These aren't masculine or feminine, they're higher forms of consciousness. They're fully ingrained with both of those principles. And I love that Mercury, right, is named Hermes. Think about that one. Her and me. We can talk about him next month with Gemini. Eris demoted Pluto to dwarf planet, and Ceres was upgraded. Ceres is the largest chunk in the asteroid belt between Mars and Jupiter. The biggest piece left of what was most surely at one time a planet. And there are four large chunks that are now being used in many astrological systems. And these are their glyphs. On the left, Ceres, who was Demeter, goddess of the crop, the mother. Pallas Athena, wisdom. Juno, Hera, relationships. She was the only of the Olympians that married. It wasn't the most graceful marriage given Zeus's inclinations. And on the right, Vesta, keeper of the sacred flame, Hestia, the ceremonial priestess. The Demeter George is the one who's really brought this to the forefront, though many astrologers are starting to use them. I start to use them too. Not typically in the first reading or something, but I really like to look at these feminine principles in the chart. And they were a huge piece of this lunar eclipse that we just had. So a few people here asked me to do a little weather report of the current astrological happenings since shit has been so crazy. And one of the great starting points for this wild was this blood moon on April 15th. And I went to Arizona. Jennifer was there as well. I asked this great Seattle astrologer one time, where's a good field to do some stargazing around here? And he said, oh, there's this great place down south. It's called Arizona. So I took his advice. That was Rick Levine, who has great answers to any question. And went down there to celebrate the blood moon eclipse. It was great. This was it rising. Later in the night, full moon. So this place, just to rewind, I mean, usually this is another meeting there from last October during a new moon, actually during the solar eclipse back then, and you can usually see just the full Milky Way and amazing stars. The problem with going to do some stargazing on a full moon is you don't get to see that, but we did see an eclipse. This was it beginning, a little later along, almost totally done. That was a chart. So what's up with an eclipse? You know, think about this. This is the shadow coming across the moon. In shamanic astrology, the moon is our lineage. In most of the systems, it's our feminine, our emotions. So this is a time for us to go into the shadow. And these eclipse cauldrons, as one of my teachers likes to call them, there's two eclipse seasons every year, where we can get lunar and solar eclipse, oftentimes back-to-back, as we've just had. And this lunar eclipse, it's about the shadow, in a sense, like the shadow of the heart, to get into our shadow. And it was probably necessary at the time. I was really guiding people that I was working with to kind of get in there and not feel like it's a bunch of work, but to go down there and high-five yourself and realize that we've checked a lot more off the list than we usually give ourselves credit for. The other thing about a lunar eclipse is you get every phase of the moon, which usually takes 29 and a half days, in like 3 hours. This one was more like 4.5 because the moon was far from us. So it's this acceleration of time. So you can do this accelerated shadow work. And whether that was your intention or not, maybe some of you have participated with that nature over the last couple weeks. So this is the chart of that time. July, or April 15th, 12:42 a.m. I took away everything but the sun and the moon. So there's the sun, 25:16 Aries, and the moon, 25:16 Libra, right across from each other, full moon. And because they're so close to the lunar nodes where the orbit of the moon and sun cross, we have a total lunar eclipse, a blood moon. I'm going to add some points. There is Ceres, Demeter, asteroid goddess representing motherhood. There is Vesta, sacred flame, virgin priestess, all right next to this eclipse. That's Juno, relationship. So all of the asteroid goddesses straight in alignment with the eclipse, besides Pallas Athena, who was in perfect trine and sextile to this lunar eclipse. And if I put in the ascendant, you see this kind of beautiful kite form. A few hours later in the night, or really just less than an hour, this perfect kite forms between the four asteroid goddesses, all aligned to the lunar eclipse and what was rising at that time. So this beautiful grand fire trine with all of this charged feminine energy bringing us in, into the feminine, into the heart. And so now, showing you another up here, and that's Spica. S7 on this software. Spica is the brightest star of Virgo, the Virgin Priestess. It makes my voice crack. And so all of this feminine energy totally aligned to this eclipse. This is what it looked like in the sky. Let's start it over. The blood moon. Red because Earth's sunsets from both sides are being cast onto the surface of the moon while the blue and yellow lights are refracted. This is Spica. And when Venus is not visible in the night sky, this was a substitute for the goddess. Venus disappears often because she's between Earth and sun. She'll get lost in the sun's glare. So you can sometimes see her in the evening sky and other times in the morning sky before sunrise, but between, she is lost. She disappears from the world stage. Our idea is that's when she goes into the underworld. And when she did, there's many different Sumerian writings, and it seems from the Mayans as well that this star would take her place. Up there is Mars. So this eclipse, right in line, Saturn was about here, actually a little further underground, but it was visible. And a really cool thing in Arizona is that we could not see many stars due to the full moon. When the eclipse took place, they all came out. You know, so we went into our shadow and the light of the heaven shows itself. And then the moon came back. We had this full wolf moon. This is it setting at the end of the night. So our ceremony ended. We had like a prayer ceremony around the fire. It was a lot of fun. I hope to do more of that stuff in the future. This is the after party showing that we survived the next day. But things did not end. The Grand Cross. Da, 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 da. So everyone's been talking about this. You're interested in astrology, most likely, or you would not be here listening to me babble. It's a very strong alignment, this Grand Cross, and we're going to watch it over time a little bit. So here is the Spica Mars Moon situation. I'm going to bring planets back in. There's Uranus in Aries, in direct opposition to Mars, and look how they're doing the same thing with the sun and the moon. Jupiter, Pluto. So this is the grand square, the grand cross. Pluto, Uranus, Jupiter, Mars. Take the sun and the moon away so you can just see those four. That night, Mercury, when it really was starting with that blood moon, was totally aligned. And right with Jupiter, that's Sirius. the star represented by Isis in the feminine as well. And Venus was in perfect trine to them, this harmonious, beautiful aspect, and right with healers Chiron and Neptune. So it was about feminine healing, as far as I'm concerned, the healing of the evolution within. So again, I'm going to make everything disappear with these four planets of the Grand Cross, and we cruise through time. Should bring the moon back in, because the moon kind of sparked this thing off. On April 20th, the moon conjuncted Pluto, and I started getting a lot of calls for astrology readings. And I did about 25 during that Grand Cross week, and was just amazed by how strong people were, like, in their devotion to their evolution right now. I've been calling this thing the exclamation point in the middle of the sentence of awakening. And so I feel like the last couple of years, these great changes most of us have been feeling and allowing ourselves to go through, it was really kind of focused. It's alive now still, but last week was the target week. April 23rd is the strongest alignment. And here's the 27th and 28th, when it conjuncted the next point, Uranus. Two nights later, the Taurus new moon was a solar eclipse. This is like today, and then tomorrow, moon conjuncts Jupiter. And the cross is still very strong. Mars is retrograded, kind of out of it now, but not all the way. And I stopped that to bring in Saturn and Chiron, which are now in Scorpio and Pisces. Because as Jupiter moves out of the Grand Cross this month, this is 2 days from now, it moves into this beautiful grand water trine alignment with Saturn and Chiron. Last year we had the grand water trine with Scorpio Saturn, Pisces Neptune, and Cancer Jupiter. And this year it's more of the same, but with Chiron instead of Neptune from the Pisces vertex. The grand water trines are said to be a time of true harmonious healing, feeling, dreams, visions. Chiron, the shamanic healer. Jupiter, guru, opportunity, expansion. And Saturn, the rules. And so more of us releasing rules around Scorpio stuff. Rules that would prevent us from being authentic in our open human hearts and communicating our love, our anger, whatever it may be, so we live a more authentic life. And so as the cross fades, this grand trine holds, and that's this month. So we've kind of been through a bit of a storm. Nice work with that. And that's still alive for sure, but it's becoming more harmonious. And some of the reward and the support for this growth that you've allowed in yourselves is coming. Is here, always. So the moon game. I used to do this every month, and I haven't for a while, so if people are new to my raps, this is something I play. I usually participate with astrology around the lunar calendar. And so Taurus started for me on the 29th. And that was this annular eclipse. Do I have a picture? Yeah. The Ring of Fire eclipse. This is not a picture from it. If it is, it's from Papua New Guinea, because that was like the only place it could be seen. It was mostly like in the middle of the Pacific. But we started with an eclipse. And again, right, eclipse isn't, the solar eclipse isn't about the shadow, but now it's the moon, the emotions coming to block the fuel or the fire in some ways. And so again, you know, on the other end of that Grand Cross, the strongest point of that Grand Cross, now it's like, bam, back into the heart. High fives. And so my moon game, I always have these on my website, morethanastrology.com. And you can read about it there. I don't want to take our time. In fact, we should kind of be done with the astro babble so we can listen to Yaima, Moss, and Pepper play some music. There's two more dates, because I'm autistically astrological. This is May 14th. Look at that here. So, the full moon. And on that day, you can see in this chart on the right, this is at the time that they're setting, very early in the morning, 5 a.m. This is a moon-Saturn occultation. So when the moon can jump Saturn, when it passes Saturn in the sky, usually it'll be above or below Saturn. But during this time right now, it's passing right over, right in between, and it's occulting Saturn, it's hiding Saturn. And people who have done readings with me that are in Saturn transits, we work on rewriting the rules, and these are amazing times to do that because the rules are hidden, right? And then they're revealed again. And so it's like, now I see you, you bastard, and I change you. So I love this date. And here's another one, May 25th. Crescent moon can jump Venus in the morning sky, which are always beautiful, but we work with these in a really deep and ceremonial way in the shamanic astrology. Paradigm, more on that another time. But thank you so much for coming, everyone, and bearing the heat, making it hotter. I think maybe we'll watch mushrooms grow and listen to some music for a while. You're welcome to hang out as long as you want. I should say one more thing. It's Pepper Proud's birthday. And so I brought a bunch of little cupcakes. I'll pass those around. Please be neat because we are sitting in a yoga studio. And thanks again. Thank you. distraction, sir.
Oh, nice.
And there's like, there's boxes around. So.
Oh my gosh.
Get your cupcake on.
Aw, thank you.
Happy birthday, Pepper. Does anyone want to sing?
Yeah.
Happy birthday.